My name is Aileen Dulligan, and I'm just going to explain a little bit about myself before I begin. I'm an English language teacher at an English studio in Dublin, and I've been teaching for just a little over 2 years. This year I completed my Delta. I decided to go to London to do it, and I wasn't working, I was doing a 12-week course, so it was really super intense. I picked up a lot of things, but in such a short space of time, it's only now that I'm really working towards everything I've learned. One of the things I took from my course, one of the things I enjoyed most was learning about task-based teaching. And that's why I'm here. I'll just be talking about my experience of trying to implement it in my classroom. So first of all, what is task-based teaching? For anyone who doesn't know, Scott Thornbury says it's a lesson where the task is the basic unit of planning and teaching. While Larson, Freeman, and Anderson say that TBL, or task-based learning, gives priority to communicating over predetermined linguistic content, grammar or lexis, teaching through communication rather than for it. So the second thing I have to contend with on this course is, what is a task? I mean, I don't know how much you know about task-based learning, but when I started teaching, I was like, everything in a course book is a task. Like, I'm doing this. It's, oh, I don't know why I need to learn any more about this. I'm doing a task every day. But then in my course, I got to learn a little bit more about this. And Dave and Jane Willis, who I read a lot from about this, they defined what a task is by asking these six questions. Does the activity engage learners' interest? Does it have a primary focus on meaning? Will there be an outcome to this task? And is success judged in terms of this? Is completion a priority? And does the activity relate to real-world activities? I think what I like the most about task-based learning is that this last point, is it relevant? Is it real communication for communication's sake? So you can have types of tasks, and I got this from Dave and Jane Willis's Doing Task-Based Teaching from 2007. You can have comparing tasks, ranking and sorting tasks, which I think are my favourite to bring into the classroom because they're quite easy to make yourself. You've got problem-solving tasks, projects and creative tasks, which is always quite nice because you give a little freedom to students, a little bit more freedom to students, and sharing personal experiences and listening. So just to choose one of them, we're going to have just a quick look at types of listing tasks. So you get your students to list qualities of a world leader, which I think works quite nicely with an advanced group. I have done it before, and the things, you know, that they come out with, especially with the current political climate in the world. So that works really well for a higher level. I think for lower levels, pre-intermediate, intermediate groups, criteria for choosing a place to stay for holiday is a nice list to make. And it's also handy if they're planning any trips while they're over here, which many of them do. Just yesterday, I had two students bring in their suitcases because straight after class, they were going away. And then for every level, I think it's possible to talk about or to list strategies for learning English outside of the classroom. It's a nice, helpful one, and it's very informative. My personal favourite is Desert Island Toolkit. There's a lovely activity on teachthis.com where you have a picture of about 20 things you can choose from if you're stuck in a desert island, but you can only choose 5, and then you join a group, and then you can only choose 3, And it's your job to persuade other people. And you have to agree or disagree. There's loads of ways we can do this and help students use this language in a meaningful way. Although let's hope nobody ever gets done and does
or has done
in the past. Plenty of personal experience. So I wanted to give you just a little bit of my personal experience. What did I do? The first time I used task-based teaching was during my course. We had a personal development assignment, and your experimental lesson, you could choose task-based learning, you could choose dogma, which is terrifying, you could choose desuggestopedia, which I found very confusing. So I knew when I was doing my course, I had a real issue with taking student language and upgrading it or reformulating it. So I chose this TBL to kind of help me help them in a way. With this group, I had a mixed low intermediate B1 group of 12 or more students. And the lesson aim was, by the end of the lesson, students will be better able to talk about qualities that make a good employee. And I knew from doing a needs analysis of my whole group that they were living in London, but they weren't working. They really wanted to work, and they really wanted to know more business terminology and how to present themselves in a job interview. So I thought this was an ideal task. So I made a ranking task, and I put a list of 7 qualities, and they had to choose which ones were most important. This is what it looked like. This is my first ever one, like even looking at it now, I'm kind of mortified. So what makes a good employee? Write these qualities in order of importance to you. Your students will do this alone, then they'll compare and they'll have a chat to see what similarities or differences each person in the class had. I found this quite challenging to make because of the language I was presenting. Did I want to have difficult language or challenging language first, or was it just about communicating? Trying to find that balance I found quite tough. So I'm just going to run through the framework of a task-based lesson if people aren't really familiar with it. I started with a pre-task activity to kind of whet the appetite or do a lead-in. So I at the beginning of the lesson, I told my students of a job interview gone wrong. We've all had them, and actually it's a good way to share stories with you and your students. I told them about a job interview I had a number of years ago where I lied because I was really desperate to get a job. They figured it out, and it was really embarrassing, but you know, it's still a good story and it's really funny. So then I asked them if they had any similar experiences, and they go off and have a chat with their partner or their group next to them. And then I monitor. Monitoring during this type of lesson is very important because at this point you want to collect what language they already have, because then you know that by the end of the lesson or by the language focus stage, you know what gaps need to be filled. So then you nominate two students or two pairs to answer about their experiences, to kind of broaden, like it's to align the atmosphere, I think. It's quite nice. Then the task cycle begins. So for this task, I explained what the ranking task was. I gave them the task. And then they worked alone, just 2 minutes, pick and choose what your preference is. And then when they're comparing, it's really important to get them to not show their answers. Because if they show their answers, they're not really likely to explain. They're just going to show. And that really, like, I learned the hard way, if you let that happen, you have no language to kind of upgrade. So I have to make very sure that they were not showing each other. It's a bit of a secret. Then when the task has been done and they've explained it, they have to plan how they're going to present their information to the rest of the group. Okay, so it's like a little mini presentation of sorts. So they report that there are similarities and differences to the class. Who will speak? What structure will your answer take? I once made a student cry because they didn't want to do a presentation. And I felt terrible, they felt terrible, the whole class felt terrible. So students who are quieter, like myself, if they don't want to talk too much, I don't really put that much pressure on them. But we have a chat, a chat at the end of the class, maybe, because I never want that experience again. It's important at the reporting stage, you're just asking pairs, you know, what do they find out about each other? If you have a large group, it's hard to get feedback from every group without it affecting pace. Mm-hmm. I learned this as well, because you might be hearing repetitive answers, and students might be bored and it'll drop the energy in the classroom. Mm-hmm. But if you have a smaller group, by all means chat to everyone about it. It would be quite nice. You decide how much feedback you give on this. Then the meat of the lesson, I think, is language focus. By this point in the lesson, you have kind of compiled a list of all the language you're noticing, how you can improve it. Is there anything that they're really missing? Depending on the level, what should they be using at this point? And then you board it, and you make sure that your students write a copy of what you're writing on the board in their notebooks. They can look at it or they can check their phones, but if you tell them, make this list in your notebook, you know, they'll always have it. Mm. And then when you go through meaning, form, pronunciation and drilling if necessary, you just let the students have a chat about, you know, what language do they like, what would they use, a little bit of reflection at this point. And then afterwards you do the task again, except with a different partner. Okay, so you're going, you may not do the task again because it's a use of paper that you don't need, but you might just get them to explain to a different partner what their preferences are, and it works quite well. When I was doing this, I ran out of time to do the task repetitions, so you need to be really aware of timing when you're doing this, especially if you're doing an observation, or if you're doing an observation, if you're being observed, or if you just, you know, what time you're finishing and when you have to complete things. But it's always quite nice. Some students can be resistant to it because they're like, why are we doing this again? We've already done it. Mm-hmm. But I think as long as you stress, you know, I want you to try to use this language if you can, see if it works for you. I probably wouldn't spend too long on task repetition, but it gives the students an opportunity to try it out, see if it fits. And what response did I get? Now that I've completed my Delta, I've been teaching a few different levels, and it's something I like to do maybe once or twice a week. If students really don't like it, I might leave it at 2 weeks, 3 weeks, whatever. But I find lower levels love task-based learning because it gives them a chance to talk and the teacher steps away. Because all they want to do is talk. They want to communicate, mm-hmm. and they want to communicate in a way that's more meaningful than here's a couple of questions from the book, try to find out your answers from your partner, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Especially if it relates to what they're doing in their free time, it helps a bit. For higher levels, talking didn't really fascinate them as much, but they were really interested in the upgraded language. Mm-hmm. How can I sound more advanced? Having longer chunks of language on the board, my advanced students who are lovely, just the best advanced group ever, I hope they watch this, they really appreciate the longer chunks of language that I can give them as a native speaker, but also someone from Ireland who might say something a little bit different, mm-hmm. differently. When I was teaching in London, I had a student who kind of asked me to stop speaking because they didn't want my accent.
Oh,
it's really pushing. But I find that my students are here, if they're learning in the country, they want to know all the Irish isms. Mm-hmm. They want to know a little bit of Gaelic as well, a little Capon Tay and all that kind of stuff, which is quite nice. How it helped me develop as a teacher. for anyone who's thinking of doing it or maybe has done it but hasn't done it in a while, I can only recommend it. This paragraph here is a little bit of the text from my assignment on my Delta course. And it was up at the top. I was justifying why I wanted to try task-based learning. I chose it for my experimental practice because I'd like to improve on giving feedback to students, dealing with emerging language confidently, because I was worried that, like, I would get it wrong or they didn't want what I was going to give them, and language clarification as well, and tuning into the lesson. I don't know about you, but I learned monitoring on my Celta course, and then over a couple of months you start to realise you're monitoring, but it's really just standing up walking around, not doing anything. But my Delta course, and this actually helped me tune into different conversations to try to mind them, pick out the language that I wanted to work on or I wanted to upgrade for them. And just to reiterate, I guess my brain's fast, I don't know. The benefits of TBL, you focus on meaning instead of form, which is an alternative to PPP. I think Laura has mentioned this. Because we all do PPP when we begin, and then to mix it up a little bit, we can try TBL. It gives them a chance to talk and then look at language. It fosters genuine communication, and I think especially in higher levels, they realise this. Mm-hmm. My advanced group are not really keen, well, I can't speak for everyone, but I know the general idea is they're not really keen on course books. They want language that they know that they will need and that they're going to use outside of the classroom. And this has definitely helped them. The repetition cycle at the end helps students to upgrade and play with language. It's not all just learn. Mm-hmm. It's play with it. See if it fits, because not everything you teach them is what they want to learn and want to remember. It's also really good for a teacher because it's a materials light approach. The only thing I needed for that lesson, 1 hour lesson, was that task. Everything else was me and the students just talking and picking up language. And yeah, it's an alternative to PPP. So thank you.